Hi, everybody. Welcome back. Today I'm going to try and do a quick little painting. I thought I'd just try to do some fuchsia, the flower fuchsia. And I was going to do it in my book, but I thought I'd do a little one on a card just to show you how simple it is. So I also had a little art supply haul that I thought I'd share with you as well. As this painting that we're doing today. And a few things came for me. Some of you had been asking if I would do some oil painting. And then I had another viewer ask if I do water mixable oils and if I could teach about those. So I plan to do that very soon, as soon as I'm feeling good enough to go through that setup process and everything. It takes a little bit longer to set up, and although oil paint can sit out for a lot longer than acrylic can, as you know, I haven't been feeling well, so I'm just waiting before I do that. So anyway, but I thought I'd show you what I got. Well, one of the things I got today was some pencil extenders. These things are great, and I'm hoping they'll be great for my pencils. All my pencils are downstairs by my couch because that's where I've been laying the last few days, and I have been doing a little drawing in my black sketchbook. I got a few sketches done, but these tighten here, so I'm hoping that they will... It looks like they squeeze in a little bit on the pencil. So I'm going to grab just a regular pencil here. I have something. Let's see. Oh, here's an old Reeves pencil. It's been sitting here for years. I'm going to try putting this in here. See how it works. But you know how short my white pencil had gotten. Whoops, I took it off. Well, you can see the center of this has little slits down the side of the mouth here. And that's what squeezes in on your pencil. So let me get that on there like that. Put this in like that. And then you can extend your pencil by sticking it in there like that. And then you tighten it down until it doesn't tighten anymore. And then you've got a pencil extender. These work great so that you can get down to the bottom of those pencils that get real short and stubby, like my white ones do. It should handle all standard pencils. I'm going to grab another type of pencil over here. This one, I don't even know what it is. Oh, it's a Derwent burnisher. So I'm going to stick that. Oh, yeah, that'll fit too. So, nope, it won't fit. Some pencils do not fit in there, but let me see. I've got some other pencils here. I wonder, I bet my Inktense pencils will not fit either because they are a little bit fatter. Let me just grab. Yeah, I doubt these will fit. I probably would have to get a Derwent pencil extender, yeah, for those kinds of pencils, but that's okay. My Derwents are all fine. I don't use them that much. But anyway, they'll work for pastel pencils as well, although I do have some Derwent pastel pencils. This Staedtler pencil fits no problem, so that's pretty good. And what are these? These are also Derwent. This is a blender. Derwents are thicker. They get you because they want you to use their products, you know? So anyway, I've got three of these. I've lost so many of these over the years, and I bought a set of three for just a couple dollars. I mean, it really was very inexpensive. I will link everything in the description box down below. These are called Cosmos, C-O-S-M-O-S, pack of three assorted lengthener extender holders. And so those are great. But if you have Derwent pencils, beware that your Derwent pencils are a bit thicker, and you probably need to get a special Derwent holder for that. These will work for Prismacolors, I'm pretty sure. I will grab those in just a minute and we will check them. But since you all, and another thing that I wanted to show you were Since you've been asking about oil painting, I had gotten a set of pencil or brushes, some real cheap ones, oh, a couple months ago. I never showed you guys because I wasn't really doing oil painting at all. But this is just a cheap set. So if you're starting in oil painting, these could be good for you. I got these. These are called Artify. They came in this pencil box. So these are the brushes that I got months ago. I haven't even used them yet. I haven't done any oil painting in quite a while. It's probably been 5 months. But anyway, this is a large roll. And it measures open. It measures probably about 19, 20 inches. Let's see. About 19 and a half inches. And I bet it's about a foot tall, 13 inches high. And it Velcros on either end like this, so it holds your edge down, which is really nice. And you could use this for any brushes, but this came with a bunch of different brushes for me. One half of it was flats and the other half was rounds. Whoops, I'm sorry. And these ones, I forget, some of them were, was it horse or I don't know what kind of fur. And then they had nylon flats. I had 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 18 in these flats. And then 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 in some hog bristle flats. And you need stiffer brushes, a little bit stiffer brushes for oil painting. And then the other half was all rounds. And I still have to soak these and clean them. And these are the same, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. And then I got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 4, 10, 12, 18 of these rounds. And then 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 again in the hog bristle rounds. So there's quite a few here. But these were really cheap brushes, and I didn't know how they were going to paint. These flats are actually very soft. They could probably be used for watercolor. But anyway, I got those quite a while ago, a long time ago. So then I wanted to get a set of filberts. I like filberts for oil painting. I use a lot of flats and a lot of filberts in oil painting for some reason. So I bought these, and they're an off-brand. They had very good ratings. These are all long-handle brushes. Oil painting brushes tend to be long-handled, although some companies are making short-handled ones now. These are called Creative Colors. It says they are the best painting brush. What a claim. It says the brushes are shipped with water-soluble glue on the hairs to maintain the protective and protect the tip. So it's imperative that the glue is removed entirely before you start using your brush. The best way to do this is to first rinse out as much glue as you can, then soak the brush tip. Use cool water, gently brushing the tip against the palm of your hand is sufficient to loosen the glue. And then once you've done that, then you can brush. I thought it said, this is Red Sable in something, but I can't remember what. And they look beautiful. And yes, they've got gum arabic on the tip. So I'm going to just soften one of these. It takes a little bit to soften a brush, but there's quite a bit of glue on this. Oh, it's coming off pretty quickly. Always want to rinse them and not crack the tip. Never break the tip of your brushes. It's not good for them because you can actually break hairs off when you do that. Okay, so these are already softened, or this one is. I would soak it a little more. And when they say soak it, it's a matter of rinsing it in water and then just laying it out with nice wet brush in order to let it soak. You don't sit it in your water and cover the ferrule of your brush and all of that. So anyway, this is a nice soft brush. I'm really excited to use these. So I will be doing some oil painting as soon as I'm up to it. And these are 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and 12. And this Creative Colors is a brand I'd never heard of, but since it was getting great reviews on Amazon, and it was inexpensive for these brushes, for 6 brushes, I know it was under $30. But anyway, we'll see how they work when I paint with them for the first time. You guys will be there with me. And then another thing that I got that I had been losing over time, and this happens to me all the time, especially when I'd be out plein air painting or whatever, I lose my knives over months or years. So I got a full set of knives. These are palette knives, and they're great for mixing your paints. When you're using oil paints, it's best to mix your paints with a knife so that you don't destroy your brushes. And I got so many knives in this set, and I think it was like $10 or $13. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 11 knives. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11, yeah. I got a couple of these flat knives. These are by Conda, C-O-N-D-A, palette knives. And so I've got a couple of these. This one is a nice flat tip. Let me take it out of its packaging. And then the other one is a little bit different. The handles are nice and soft. It feels like they've been sanded well and varnished. So they're nice and there's nothing that's going to splinter or anything there. This is the 1007 brush. And it's, like I said, got a nice flat tip. Great for scooping and for lines. This one is more of a decorative knife. Did I call it a brush? I meant knife. And this one you can use when you're painting. It's got little ruffled edges or something. You can see it here. And you can make lines in your paintings. Then there's a series of regular palette knives. A few of them are pointed, a few of them are rounded. Got some nice big ones. This is nice spatula size knife. And they're numbered. It looks like they're numbered 10-0. Oh no, they're not. They're all different. Okay. I thought they were like 1 through 11, but they're not. This is 1016 by Conda. So it sounds like you can buy these separately since they're, I'm sorry, hang on. Since they're all individually wrapped, it looks like they can be bought individually, but this one is nice and small. I love these little small ones when I'm doing small paintings and I want to paint with a palette knife, which I'm still learning. I'm not real comfortable with palette knife painting. I get way too much paint on my canvas, but I want to continue to learn that. And if I ever master it, I will teach you what I've learned, but I'm in the learning process. So anyway, I'm not going to unwrap all of these, but you can see, let me just unwrap these two so I can show you the difference in them. See, this one has a nice sharp tip. These are great for edges for painting. This is more of a painting knife, and this is more of a palette knife. They can be used interchangeably, but the rounded edge is real great for mixing. You see how the diamond shape is way back toward the handle. This one is way forward from the handle, almost halfway down the knife. And it comes to a point, and this one is rounded. So you can see the difference in them. But anyway, that's my set of knives, and I'll teach you all about knives down the road. But since we're watercolor painting today, I'm not going to get into it. And then this was something that I've been wanting to get for a long time. I need to grab something else. For plein air painting, I thought this would be wonderful to have. If you use metal palettes, this could be great. And I want to grab a board here. I'm just going to grab a small board so it fits in camera. But, and this one has been gessoed with clear gesso already. But a lot of these MDF boards, I use these panels for oil painting on. And I have even done some pastel painting on them, but they're not as smooth as I like. So if you're out painting and you've got a big board, not something this small, and let's say you're out, oh, this isn't cleaned. Ugh. Let's say you're out painting and you want to have your palette on the side and your book on the other side. You might think, well, how am I going to hold on to this? And it's hard. I don't want it to fall off. Well, I got these very cheaply, a set of 18 magnetic clips. And these are small ones. These are 1.5 inch, I think. They make them all different sizes. But what you do is you have the magnet facing upward. You put it on your board like this. And you stick your palette to it. And then it is adhered. It's pretty cool. I can have it way out off the board even. Isn't that neat? And then you can paint and you can even tilt it. I've got it almost vertical here. And it's still hanging on. If you're uncomfortable, use two. Very easy to use two. Just stick it like that on the corner. So, and then you have your book down here, and you can be dipping. Well, if you're right-handed, dipping and painting. So anyway, I was real excited to get these. And these will be sitting in my sketch bag so that when I go out painting, I have the ability to use them. You can even use larger palettes, no problem. Oops, my ultramarine came out of there. So if I'm using a bigger palette like this, you can still use it. Put a clip on either side like that. And keep it way off to the side. Open this up. These are my core paints. And you can have it on the edge of your board. I would put it on my left-hand side. And, of course, this board is very small. This is just an 8x10 or 9x12 board, but I would be using a lot larger board for a palette of this size. But then when you're holding it, you can hold it in your hand like this on your forearm and just sketch away. And you can also clamp your books down so that they don't move. But aren't these cool? I was so excited to get those, and they were very inexpensive. For a set of 18, those should last me a lifetime unless I'm losing them everywhere. But yeah, so I was really happy with getting those. I thought I'd just be getting like 3 or 4, but it was cheaper to actually get 18 than it was to just buy a set of 3. So I thought, okay, I'm going to get them. So that's what I did. So that's it for my art supply haul that I got. And if you're a sketcher, those magnetic clips might be worthwhile for you. So now I'm going to get back to the painting. So I tore a piece of paper because I wanted a rough edge. I'm going to make this into a card. Somebody had asked for some simple cards, so I'm just going to show you how I draw my fuchsia on. And it's very, very simple. You won't have any trouble with this. So let me just zoom you in a little bit here and try to get you. I don't want to brighten this too much. Is my light up all the way? Yeah. I don't know. Here, let me see if I can brighten this just a tinge. There, maybe that'll help. I don't want it too bright. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a few fuchsia in different levels of maturity. So, I'd like to have one coming down right about here. So I'm just going to draw this line. I don't want them too dark. I hope you can see. Then they kind of bulb out, and then there's a longer bulb that's kind of pink that goes on beyond that. I'm going to put a petal right in front, kind of an oval shape. And then I'm going to bring one out, like almost straight out, but on an angle a little bit. And it's going to come down. And then this one's going to come up at a little different angle. I don't want it too perfect. Then in the background, I'm going to have a couple too. There. So that's the top half. Oops, I'm sorry. Very simply done. And then on the bottom, since this is open but not fully open, I'm going to have this a little droopy on the bottom. And I'm just going to add some petals in. Whoops, I didn't want that to wiggle though. And then on the back side, I need to show the underside of the petals over there. So I'm just going to put those in as well. And then you'll have the little dangly pollinating, whatchacallits coming down. I forget the name of them. I'm not a botanist, so forgive me. So that's that one. And I'm not going to draw the other part. And I'm going to have a bud coming off over here, I think, off to the side. And that's going to have the first little bulb. And I believe they get the second little bulb. Hang on, I gotta check it again. Okay, this is just a Shutterstock photo, so it's gonna be hard to see below it, but these are the pink things coming out. This is a newer flower, and you can see the green bulb there. And then you can see the pink thing hanging down off of it. Now here's a more mature bulb that's already all pink. Some of them are green when they start, and they don't have that second portion to it, and that's what I was forgetting. And then you can see when they start to turn up how you can't see the pink part. Actually, in this one you can. That's not a petal. That's the thing holding it together, and it shows that there's four things that point up. So, I think I had five on this one. Well, my recording, I was off frame for most of the drawing, so I'm going to show you the drawing again real quick. I'm just going to brighten this up a little bit again so you can see me. I don't want it too bright. So what I did, let me get my picture here. My first one I had coming down. I make a little stem just coming down. It doesn't even have to go all the way to the top. Then I have a little bulb coming off. And then that's the green portion. And then there's the pink portion that holds the flower on to the stem. And I have my two petals coming off to the side. And I bring them up like that. And then I had two in back that kind of popped up and kind of curled a little bit. They don't have to be even. Don't have to make them symmetrical. But let me see if you can see that. I'll come zooming in here so you can see. So you see the four petals. Now, it is maturing. It hasn't curled up yet, though. So the bottom portion is still going to be a little bit droopy. And I'm just going to put some flower petals on here. And make that like that. This one actually looks a little bit different than my last one, but that's okay. And then I want to have the back portion also showing through because I'm going to have my little stamens coming down. That's what they're called. So that's that portion. And then over here I decided to put a bulb coming down off the side. I gave it a little round, or the little round bulb, and then it's going to be round. So what I did was, this one's not going to be mature. It's just still going to be green. So it's going to be almost a round ball. And that's how that one's coming down. And it comes a little bit to a point, but not quite. Then, back over here, I've decided to put one up high. And I've got the I made a mistake on my other one, I see. Got the green portion, the pink portion, then this one's going to be curling up because it is more mature. So I'm going to have it starting to curl. That side, that one, and then these are curling in the back too. This one's sloppier. I shouldn't be doing it so sloppy because I can make another card out of it. And then this one, I'm going to have my petals coming way, way out to the sides because they're opening up too. But the bottom portion is still going to show. I don't like the way this is looking. Let me do this again. I shouldn't have rushed through that. Okay, so we got the stem, the little round doohickey, the pink coming down that attaches to the bottom. I'm going to have these curling up. And they don't have to be pointy on the ends. They can have a rounded tip a little bit. And this one's going to round up too. And it's going to come up over the bottom portion. And then this one's going to come up like this. And this one's just going to come straight up. There we go. Okay. Now, I hope this is bright enough for you. Can you see this? There. If I move this light away. There we go. That's better. Okay. Now, down here, I want to have another bulb. But before that, I'm going to put in a very immature fuchsia that has not fully opened yet down here. So I'm going to put my little green bulb. Then I'm going to have the pink one because it is opening. And then I'm going to have these coming down instead of up. I'll have one coming off the front and then another one off the side. Like this. And then this is going to be round on the bottom. Like that. So you see the roundness coming down here. This one can come down like that a little more. Actually, I'm going to make this one go out to the side a little more just to round it out and make it prettier. There we go. There. And then I'm going to have one more coming in this way. And this one's going to be immature again, only it's going to be less immature than the other one. So I'm going to make another round bulb. Only when I get to the bottom, I'm going to have it separating like that. Okay, so now that I've got the drawing down, let me back out a little bit so you can see the whole thing. It was very simple to draw. Very simple. Don't be afraid to try it. And later we'll put the stamens in that are going to come down like this. But I don't want to put them in yet. I don't want them in pencil at all. So I think I'm also going to put in some leaves. So I'm going to make a stem come across this way. And I'm going to put a leaf coming off here. They're very simple leaves, nice kind of pointed tip leaves. And then I've got another one that I brought out this way. And then I have one coming off of this plant here. That one kind of curves and then it comes way down like this. And I got one coming down just out of nowhere from up top. And another one coming up for this. And that's about it. And now we're ready to go. You might want to put a branch coming down here with another leaf. It's up to you. I think I'll just have one come down off of here. I didn't have one on the other. And then I'll just have this stem come up here like that. It has to go to something, so that's what I'll do. Okay, so let's get painting, shall we?
The next thing I want to do
is I want to wet around my edges, and I'm just going to take my bigger round brush, excuse me, a size 8, and I'm just going to go around my edges here. And today I'm using my Sennelier paints. I think I mentioned that already, but maybe I didn't because I'm redoing this portion of the video. I painted some fuchsia the other day, but I still wasn't feeling quite up to snuff, so they didn't come out very well. So I wanted to redo it, show you just how easy this is. Now, I'm not going to fill the whole thing in with color. This isn't going to be like a botanist type of a painting. But I just want some color on the edges. And I'm going to take a little golden color. What I did was I used my Sennelier paints. And since I don't have a quinacridone gold, I took burnt sienna and yellow. And I mixed it together to get this color. And now I'm just going to drop it in here and there. Hopefully I'll get a little bit of flow with this, but I don't know. Maybe not. And I want to take a little bit of cobalt blue. Let me wet this a little bit more. And that can mix in and make a green. I don't know how green it'll become because of the pigment, the burnt sienna pigment in there. It's dried pretty quickly today. It's raining outside. My goodness, it snowed overnight. And now it's raining, and we're supposed to get to almost 50 degrees today, which is amazing. It's February. We've had the weirdest winter. We haven't had much snow at all. So strange. I don't like that green. I need to take a different green in here. I'll leave a little bit of the white there. I'm going to use some ultramarine blue in here just to make that a little darker. That cobalt wasn't mixing well. And I know ultramarine and burnt sienna will make a gray. It won't turn mud. So, and then I'm going to pull out my, this is a number 4 Rosemary & Company Series 307. This is a Rosemary & Company Eclipse, and it's actually a 3, but it's bigger than the 4 of this series. So I'm going to use this one. So you hear me say numbers, it doesn't mean a whole heck of a lot. I'm going to show you this one and then I will speed it up. Now I've made puddles of pink, my purple. They're drying up though. Let me get another brush here. My purple is right here, and that is a pre-mixed, that's a color in the palette. Then this blue-violet over here was mixed with some ultramarine blue and that purple together. So, and then I have my pink here. I'm also going to be using a little bit of this, I think it's a scarlet red, I'm not sure what color that is, but it's very pretty. And then I'm also going to use a little bit of orange, this deep orange, because it'll add to the petals a little bit. But I'm not going to use a whole lot of it. Okay, now grab my brush and we can get going. I'm going to grab some pink and I'm going to be mixing my colors right on the paper. This one's going to be all pink because it's that bulb portion that holds the plant together. What the heck is on there? There must have been something on my palette. Let me pull that up if I can get it. Okay, should probably get a new paper towel. Okay, so this I'm just going to leave pink, and then over here I'm going to drop in some pink, let it bleed in on its own. If it's not too dry already, it may be too dry already. Not too bad. And then I want to add some of that purple in down at the base. which you don't really see with fuchsia. It's usually pink on top, purple underneath, but I want to add some color to them to give them some variety, you know what I mean? They don't have to be perfect because they're just a watercolor flower for a card, you know? And now, I would also wait for these to dry, except that I want it to bleed together again. I want some of that purple to come down, and what I'm going to do here is take this purpley blue color. Got too much water though, so I'm going to suck that back up. There we go. Take the purpley blue color and just let that float in. And then I'm going to take some actual ultramarine blue, which is dried here. There we go. And I'm just going to stick that on the top and let that kind of bleed down. There. That got a little too dark for me. There. And now on this center one, I'm going to use purple or violet, whatever it is. And I'm going to go down to the bottom edges. And I'm going to add some blue in again, and I'm going to let that bleed in. I got to mix up some more blue here. There we go. And I'm going to do the same thing over here on the end. And then I'm going to add some of the purple in. Rinse my brush a little bit and then just bleed it out. I didn't wet that area, so you can see it's much darker than the other area. So I just wet my brush a little bit and I'm just spreading this color around. And that got a little blue, so I'm going to add a little bit of the purpley color back in here. There. Now we'll go on to this bud up here. I'll show you how I do that. Just going to wet the whole thing. That water is a little dirty here, but that's okay. You'll see it better. And I'm going to take some green. I don't know what that is, if it's sap green or what. I wish I knew where my list was. I thought I made a list for these colors, but maybe I didn't. Now, when these bulbs are new, they kind of turn almost a whitish color at the bottom. I'm going to add a little bit of my gold in, just in a couple areas for imperfections. And then I'm going to actually use my white watercolor. I know, hard to believe. And I'm going to start at the bottom, and I'm going to suck this into the green and just let it mix together. And then it kind of melds this green down into the white. And that's what it starts to do right before it changes to pink. I'm going to add a little bit of that brown on the edge there. And a little more green up top, I think. In my palette, it's this green right here that I'm using, which is the most natural. And then these other greens, I would mix some sienna in or some red or something like that to make a truer green. Maybe a little bit of blue. Okay, and now I'm going to go ahead and put the green in on this stem here. And I want a little gold again, which was my yellow, like a new gamboge. It's the orangey yellow, and a little bit of burnt sienna, and that kind of made a quinacridone gold color. There. Okay, now this is dried pretty good, so I'm going to go into the bottom here and I'm going to wet this. There's a little green on my brush, but that's okay, it's very faint. I'm going to take that purpley blue color that I mixed, the blue violet. I'm going to drop it in, but I'm going to come back here and I'm going to put in some shadows. By taking some of the blue and I'm going to bring it up to the top here by these other petals. And then I'm going to fade it down with some of this purple. It's a little bit wet though, so I'm just going to try to help this along. Okay, I'll come in later and fix this edge that has the white around it. Now, some of my edges are a little jagged because my water moved. And if you get that problem, as long as you're using a color that will lift a little bit, you can go in with your brush and just reshape the petals and take that jaggedness away. You want to do it on the inside of the petal so that the color comes inward. I also have a bit of a line around it. That's because I had too much water. Do you see that there? On this petal here, see this line? I had too much water welling up in the center, and what it did then is as it dried, the pigment was rolling off of that bubble of water and pushing the pigment out toward the edge, and that's what you get. That's kind of a bloom. That's one sort of a bloom. You don't want that. You don't want an outlined color. There are some times when you may want it dark on an edge because of shadowing or something, but we don't want that. So what I'm going to do, it's going to change the shape of my petal a little bit, but I'm just going to remove as much of that as I can by pulling that color in. Where are you here? There you are. Sorry, I've got you zoomed in really far. There. So now that should pull in and dry pretty well. Okay, let me zoom you back out again a little bit. Now I'm going to, I hope you didn't miss this. I should have looked up. Now I'm going to speed you up a little bit and I'll move on to the rest. Thank you. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and put the little pink stamens, that's what they're called, on the bottom. I can't start with this one though because I'm trying to smear this color around so it blends. I didn't want a line there. Actually, I'll just zap it with my dryer real quick. And that'll keep it from doing that. Now, I had done another one yesterday, which was a little different, and it was much lighter, and I had my colors reversed, so that's why I didn't use it. But I still like it in a way. I don't like the way these came out. They were too chunky, but I wasn't feeling well, and I think that that was part of my problem. Now, oops, that's the wrong size brush. I'm going to use a 000 Anna Mason brush and see if this works. Although it's really, really short, I may use this one. This one is a Da Vinci, and it's got a little longer line. Yesterday I had tried my my Rigger, but it is a size 2, and I need to get a 0 or a 1 because that is way too thick. So I'm going to go ahead and grab some pink on my brush. Need to wet the brush pretty heavily so that I get enough liquid on here to make it flow. This doesn't hold much, so although it is sable, so it should be a little bit better. And then I'm just going to come up to this upper petal here because this is the inside, the back side of those other petals. So I'm going to come past that. And with each one, I got to refill my... Well, I guess not. I got 2 out of that one, but that was wiggly. And that's good. And I'm going to add a little bit of purple to it because some of them are a little purple. And some of them have purple on the bottom. Some have white on the bottoms of the stamen. I'm not going to do white because it'll be too hard to see. But just adding a little purple to that. And now I'm going to put these little thingajigs on the bottom here. I've seen green ones too. 4 is too little. I need another one. That just looks too symmetrical. I hate the symmetry when you do these things. So I'm going to just pull that down, add a little purple to it, and then put this on the bottom. There. I got to do one on this one too. My pink's going to drag over that green. I hope it shows through. I didn't want to mask those. You know, it's just a card, but... Get it nice and thick. There we go. Those are all the same length. I want a few of them longer, so I'm going to go over this one on the green. I'm going to add a little bit of purple to a few of them. And then put it on the bottom. That's the wrong purple. Whoops, I grabbed my eraser with my paper towel. Okay. And this really takes no time at all. This went pretty fast. So that part is pretty much done. I'm going to go ahead and sign it, and then I'm going to make a card out of it. And I'll back this up and we'll do the card. I think I'll just do a 6-inch square. Whoops, I lost my blade. I have the wrong size blade in this cutter too because it always falls out. So, well, that piece of paper has got a little nubby on the side. I wonder if it's folded under. Oh, it's okay. There we go. And I'll just go ahead and cut this. But, and I hate using watercolor paper for this, although this is just my studio paper. Fabriano Studio, which is much less expensive. If you want an inexpensive watercolor paper, shoot, that got dirty. That'll be the front. I'm going to put paper over it. The Fabriano Studio paper is really good. Oh, that got it off. Let's see if this is going to work. Oh, I guess I did cut it the right direction. Perfect. But I don't want white on white. And I think this fuchsia is going to look good. It's very bright. My lavender blind paper guys. That I liked. So I'm going to go ahead and use that. And this glue dots, I believe, is going to work much better than the other one did. That other one has no adhesive ability at all. So it is going back. Although I ordered it a long time ago. Well, a few months anyway. But this still doesn't work. I should have just went with 3M. I know it works, you know? Okay. And then that'll go on top. I had to throw the other one away because I got too close to the edge and it showed through and I thought, oh shoot, why did I do that? Okay. Waste a lot of paper. Okay, so there is my card. Very simple. And I'll put a sentiment inside, or maybe I'll just leave it blank. And but that's it. Very simple, easy to do. So go ahead and just draw yourself out a fuchsia. They're easy. A very easy flower to get down on paper. So go for it and see if you like it and be courageous, paint with wild abandon, and be kind to each other. God bless. Bye-bye.